Good morning and welcome to the midweek service. We pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. We're going to go straight for our scripture reading now, and then we're going to say the creed together after that. The reading is Ezekiel chapter 1, starting at the first verse. In my 13th year, in the fourth month of the fifth day, while I was among the exiles by the river Kabar, the heavens were opened, and I saw a vision of God. On the fifth of the month, it was the fifth year of the exile of King Jehoiakim. The word of the Lord came to Ezekiel, the priest, the son of Buzi, by the river Kabar, in the land of the Babylonians. There the hand of the Lord was on him. I looked, and I saw a violent storm coming out from the north. An immense cloud was flashing lightning and surrounded by brilliant light. The centre of the fire looked like glowing metal, and in the fire was what looked like four living creatures. It appeared their form was human, but each had the head of four faces and four wings. Their legs were straight, their feet were like those of a calf, and gleamed like burnished bronze. Under their wings, on their four sides, they had human hands. All four of them had faces and wings, and the wings of one touched the wings of another. Each one went straight ahead. They did not turn as they moved. Their faces looked like this. Each of the four had the face of a human being, and on the right side each had the face of a lion, and on the left the face of an ox. Each also had the face of an eagle. Such were their faces. They each had two wings spreading out upwards, each wing touching that of the creature on either side, and each had two other wings covering its body. Each one went straight ahead. Wherever the spirit would go, they would go, without turning as they went. The appearance of the living creatures was like burning coals of fire or like torches. Fire moved back and forth among the creatures. It was bright, and lightning flashed out of it. The creatures sped back and forth like flashes of lightning. As I looked at the living creatures, I saw a wheel on the ground beside each creature with its four faces. This was the appearance and structure of the wheels. They sparkled like topaz, and all four looked alike. Each appeared to be made like a wheel intersecting a wheel. As they moved, they would go in and out, go in any one of four directions the creatures faced. The wheels did not change direction as the creatures went. Their rims were high and awesome, and all four rims were full of eyes all around. When the living creatures moved, the wheels beside them moved. And when the living creatures rose from the ground, the wheels also rose. Wherever the spirit would go, they would go, and the wheels would rise along with them, because the spirit of the living creatures was in the wheels. When the creatures moved, they also moved. When the creatures stood still, they also stood still. And when the creatures rose from the ground, the wheels rose along with them, because the spirit of the living creatures was in the wheels. Spread out above the heads of the living creatures was what looked something like a vault, sparkling like crystal and awesome. Under the vault their rings were stretched out towards the other, and each of the two wings covered its body. When the creatures moved, I heard a sound of their wings, like the roar and rush of living waters, like the voice of the Almighty, like the tumult of an army. When they stood, they lowered their wings. Then there came a voice from above, the vault over their heads, as they stood with lowered wings. Above the vault, over the heads that were looking like a throne of lapis lazuli, and above, and high above on the throne was a figure like that of a man. I saw that from what appeared to be his waist up, he looked like glowing metal, as if full of fire, and that from there down, he looked like fire and brilliant light surrounded him, like the appearance of the rainbow in the clouds on a rainy day. So was the radiance around him. This was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord. When I saw it, I fell face down and heard the voice of one speaking. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We say together, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And we're going to hear from that prophet Ezekiel just now. It seems to be a very odd passage, doesn't it? There's a lot of very strange imagery in there. So let's pray as we begin. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word to us in the Bible, particularly in Ezekiel here, and we humbly ask that you would help us to know you better as we read it. Amen. Now, have you ever been far from home? Seems a long way off that idea right now, doesn't it, to be far from home? But actually, it's a pretty good analogy of how our lives are at the moment, because our lives are so strange to us. It's like living in a new place because we're living in a totally new way. Well, as the book of Ezekiel opens, we find that a group of Israelites have been exiled from their home. The Babylonian army had attacked Jerusalem in 598 BC, and they deported all the elite people from the country, all the leaders. We're told that King Nebuchadnezzar dragged away the king and his family and the palace officials, all the fighting men, as well as the craftsmen and all the metal workers. Essentially, he took everybody that was useful for building his empire. And removing them also removed any threat that there could be some sort of rebellion or uprising in the country, because anyone who could lead or could make any weapons had been taken. Ezekiel, the writer of this prophecy, was among those who'd been banished. And as the word of the Lord comes to him, the exiles had been a long way from home for 5 years. I think Psalm 137 captures it brilliantly. It's one you might know from the Boney M song, but great that a bit of scripture got into the charts, eh? It says, by the rivers of Babylon, we sat down and wept when we remembered Zion. There, our captors asked us for songs. Our tormentors demanded songs of joy. They said, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How can we sing the songs of the Lord while we're in a foreign land? So the exiles were in despair. I think there's a few people today in despair, particularly with lockdown coming tomorrow. They were far away from their temple and their land. They were probably wondering, you know, has our God, the Lord, been defeated by the Babylonians? And they were also probably anxious, thinking, has God abandoned us? Well, we get to see God's response to those type of questions throughout the book of Ezekiel, but not particularly in this passage. For now, also spare a thought for Ezekiel himself. Since he came from a family of priests, for all his life, all he has done, all he's been groomed for is to follow his father's footsteps, to be a priest. The usual age to begin the priestly duties was 30 years old. But when Ezekiel turned 30, instead of being in ministry as a priest, God calls him to be a prophet, to be his mouthpiece. How will Ezekiel respond to his life being turned upside down and being thrust forward in this way? And more importantly, how will the exiles around Ezekiel respond to God's word spoken to them through the prophet? Well, we have quite a spectacular opening in the book of Ezekiel. Thunderbolts, lightning, it's all very, very frightening. By the Kabar Canal or Kabar River in Babylon, Ezekiel finds himself swept up in this really weird but wonderful vision. And what Ezekiel sees in the vision is God's glory. And we sort of see that glory in three main parts. Firstly, a windstorm and four living creatures. The cloud, lightning and fire in the windstorm are reminiscent of God's presence in the pillar of cloud that went before the Israelites as they came out of Egypt. This windstorm comes from the north, which is the traditional direction from which all of Israel's enemies attacked. The creatures, they're almost grotesque. There are four of them with four faces each. I don't really know what they represent. Secondly, though, the wheels beneath the creatures. The wheels, they're wheels within wheels. It's an image of sort of fast moving and interconnection. And studied with eyes, there's something sort of all-seeing and all-moving about these wheels. And thirdly, an expanse and a throne above the creatures, this vault, this expanse. On the far side of that expanse, Ezekiel sees a magnificently bright figure. Looks to be a man, and he's on the throne. What are we to make of this crazy amount of imagery? Well, Ezekiel tells us that this was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of God. That's the key to this passage in verse 28. This is the appearance of the likeness of the glory of God. The prophet's description of the vision is very cluttered, because he can't put down in words what he saw. And his final conclusion is vague because, you know, as someone with a priestly background, he knew that you couldn't meet God face to face and live, because we're a sinful people and he's a pure God and he'd have been burned up instantly. Yet God does reveal something of himself to Ezekiel by showing him some limited aspects of his glorious character in this rather spectacular and confusing way. I think the first thing we can see is that he's different, obviously. The things in the vision are way beyond anything Ezekiel or we have ever experienced. Secondly, he is the king of everything, the whole universe. He's seated on this throne that moves around. It's able to move anywhere, any direction, and it's able to see everything, anything. Nothing is beyond the sight of this throne. And also, coming from the north means he will judge. God will judge his people. And isn't this just a foretaste, a little shadow of what the coming of Jesus is like? Because actually, this is exactly what happens. When we see Jesus, these are the characters that are revealed, the characteristics that are revealed in him. Jesus is God's ultimate revelation of his glory. Now, when Ezekiel sees this image of the likeness of God, he gets down on his face and he starts to worship him. Even in the midst of all the crazy that's going on, he's far from home, he's feeling abandoned, he's feeling forgotten and confused and sad, he's tormented. Our situation is not wholly dissimilar. We're in a much better set of circumstances. But those emotions of everything feeling weird and out of place and uncomfortable and longing to be back to a type of normality is a similar set of emotions, just a different set of circumstances. The question is, we see a vision of God in Jesus Christ. Will we still worship him even today? I think you know what my answer to that question would be. So let's worship and praise him now. Let's do that first with a song and then with a few short prayers.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever I love, thou hast taught me to say, and
Let me pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word to us in Ezekiel. And Lord, when we see the gloriousness in this strange vision, we see just how not you we are. Lord, we are so far from being the image that you made us to be. We are so distant. We are so separated by our sins. And yet you have revealed yourself to us in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we turn to you in worship and praise, looking to Jesus as our Lord and our Saviour, clinging to the foot of his cross and worshipping and praising his holy name. Amen. And as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. As we now give thanks to God for his redemption of the world through his Son, Jesus Christ, and as we remember Christ's death for us, let us draw near with faith and make our humble confession to Almighty God. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things that we ought to have done, and we have done those things that we ought not to have done, and there is no health in us. But you, O Lord, have mercy upon us sinners. Spare those who confess their faults. Restore those who are penitent, according to your promises declared to mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may live a disciplined, righteous, and godly life, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. And as we worship our King, with faces pressed to the ground, we can lift our heads and see the glory of Jesus, and know that on the cross he has pardoned and forgiven all of your sins. Amen. Hear the words of comfort our Saviour Christ says to all who truly turn to him. Come to me, all who labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you that in your tender mercy, you gave your only Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our salvation. He made there, by his once and for all offering of himself, a full, perfect and sufficient sacrifice, offering and ransom for the sins of the whole world. Now we remember how, in the same night that he was betrayed, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Amen. And we pray together. Lord Jesus Christ, though at this time we cannot share physical bread and wine, may we still feed on you in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. and we finish by praying this prayer together. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.